Awesome. And we are live.
Awesome.
Ugh. All right. So this is an impromptu, but something I think we're going to try to make annual now. What are we going to call this again?
I'm thinking we're going to call it Floral Couch Sessions, given the environment we have here.
Awesome. Well, this was supposed to be Nolo Spotlight on 91.9 The Buzz, but unfortunately the radio show had to be postponed because we've had some technical difficulties at the show. It's just playing static. But why don't you tell me what we're going to turn these into after this week?
Considering as Hard Fabric is actually gearing up to release our first LP, we kind of want to do weekly updates from here on out, or at least as often as we can, kind of like gearing people up for the album. I want to tell some stories, kind of give some more insight as to like what the tracks are about, and give updates on what's going on up until then.
Awesome. So for this first show, let's just talk about what Hard Fabric is. So give me the lowdown. What is Hard Fabric?
Okay, so Hard Fabric is actually a... I call it folk punk, but I don't really think you can describe it as one individual thing. Essentially, it's just me playing ukulele and talking about my life. There are songs about heartbreak. There are songs about small town life, anxieties, best moments, worst moments. The album's actually called "Best Part of Being Young, Worst Part of Growing Up" for that reason. It's essentially kind of a collective as well. So in addition to me playing solo on ukulele, I'll occasionally have buddies from the Statesboro music scene come in, and we've had Jarrett from Bird Person fame and Bull Moose do a cajon with us. Marissa from Bull Moose play some bass on some tracks and harmonica. So we're always trying to like incorporate new sounds into what we do.
Awesome. I love that. I like the collaboration among artists. I think it's something that more people need to do of. It's something I actually really like from the hip-hop scene, is you see a lot of features from people trying to help each other out. It gets like the fan bases going. So when did Hard Fabric start? Like, when did you begin this collective?
All right. So I actually, when I came to Georgia Southern as a freshman, I remember looking for a place to go where I could listen to music, because back home in Augusta, I would go to these open mic nights all the time with friends, and I would kind of, play some songs that I had been working on. And I was looking for that same sense of like fellowship and, you know, musical, I guess, connection that I had in Augusta. But there aren't really a lot of venues out here in Statesboro. I had actually gotten invited to this show at a venue called Big Shows for this band called Rip. Reckless Serenade. Yeah, rest in fucking peace. This was the only place in town that was doing shows other than country bar kind of shows. So I went, and afterwards went back to my friend Daniel's house. And there I met the guys of this band called Bird Person. It turns out they were all living in a house together and making music and trying to start a music scene in Statesboro. So once Big Shows got shut down, we all just started jamming together. And I remember playing one of my originals for Aaron from Bird Person and him saying like, wow, I didn't know you made music. And I was really into Bird Person at the time. So that meant like a lot to me that like he was, you know, feeling it. So I started writing some more stuff, and Hard Fabric became a thing in September of 2016, I think. It became a thing in September of 2016, and I originally started it with Marissa from Bull Moose.
Awesome. And I know you kind of started it by doing some shows at your house. You want to talk about those real quick?
Yeah, so this was something that we used to do kind of around when we were trying to get the music scene off the ground. So we would have these shows at the Birdhouse, which is actually where I'm living now. This is a room in the back of the Birdhouse. So if you've ever been here for shows, this is the behind the scenes kind of. But we were also looking for new places to kind of switch it up. And I had an apartment in this complex called Stadium Walk. We would do these living room open mic shows, real bare bones, called Acoustic Kickbacks. And that was actually where kind of the inspiration for the whole Floral Couch thing happened, because of the fact that it was literally just a bunch of people sitting around drinking beers, chilling on the couch, chilling on the floor, playing music and, you know, enjoying each other's company. So that was actually Hard Fabric's first show, was in my own living room. So I didn't have the same I guess, breakthrough that, like, a lot of artists had, where you're playing in an unfamiliar space. Like, my first show in front of people was, like, in my own space, so I feel like that helped a lot.
That'd be really comforting.
Yeah.
Surrounded by friends. Because I remember my first show that I ever played was, we were the openers at this venue called Swayze's, which is now just this terrible place. Don't support it. They support a lot of misogynistic and bigotry ideas. It's not okay.
Yeah.
But I used to play there about almost 10 years ago now.
Shit.
And yeah.
You're fucking old, dude.
Dude, I was thinking about it. My first show there, I was 15, and I'm like, I'm 23. Holy crap. There are some songs I've written that are almost a decade old.
Damn.
But we played, and it was an empty room, and then, of course, like, the next band came on, and all of their friends came in from, like, the parking lot and everything, and we're all sitting here like, what the hell, man? But it was really fun once you start getting into it and you start getting into a groove. And, I mean, I'm sure you've had those experiences where, like, you're not as receptive with friends. Do you want to talk about one of those in particular? Like, it's just a bad experience you had at a gig.
A bad experience at a gig? Geez. So starting off, obviously, I'm actually not musically trained at all. I did a little bit of band in high school. But, you know, a lot of my buddies here are, you know, they're going into music as a career. And I'm a film major. So this whole music thing, it's like I can play chords and I can write poetry, kind of. And I can kind of mash the two together. But I'm not the greatest musician ever, you know. So I used to be real self-conscious about that. I'd play shows, forget the lyrics, forget the chords. And it was there were just a few times when, you know, starting, you kind of like learn how much you can really party at gigs, like our House Fest set, which, by the way, House Fest this year is coming up on April 21st and 22nd. You should totally be there. We'll be there.
You can get your pre-sales now in the link below.
Yes. But anyways, House Fest debuted last year, and that was one of our, like, first big gigs. And obviously, it was a festival, so me and Marissa, we were both kind of partying. We were both kind of drinking. I remember we did a cover of Feel Good Inc. by Gorillaz. And we started in, like, totally different keys. And wow. the entire song was, like, us trying to get in key with each other. And it was a fucking shit show. Like, I mean, I think people still enjoyed it because everyone else was as drunk as we were. But, yeah, I kind of learned from that point on. It's like, maybe I need to practice a little bit more. Maybe I need to, you know, kind of chill out on that before a show.
Well, it's just learning about your pacing and how you can be. I mean, it's the same thing with, like, you don't go to a party and drink the hunch punch unless you know how strong it is. Like, if you go to a party, you don't know how strong the hunch punch is, and you start, like, I only had 3 cups.
Yeah.
Some hunch punches, that'll put you on your ass.
Learn that freshman year.
Easily. So, I know a lot of your songs are story-based. Can you tell us about, like, your songwriting, like, how you go about doing it? Like, what makes a Hard Fabric song come to life?
Okay, so my songwriting process is very much, it's a little bit sporadic, kind of what I do, and I know a lot of songwriters will do this. You'll be in the car or something and an idea will pop into your head and you'll turn on your voice memos and immediately just have to shout it. So I've got a lot of really stupid voice memos in my phone of just like, I'll think of like a one-liner or something and like spit it out. But kind of what I do is I'll probably implement maybe a quarter of those in songs. And then a quarter of those actually get written. Kind of what I'll do is I'll mess around with some chords and I'll write the chords first just because that's my least favorite part. I'm not a musician, like I said, so I like to get it out of the way. And then I'll try and set the song to those chords. And I'll kind of write out like specific concepts. So like if I have a concept for a song I want to write, like a song that I'm about to do is, you know, a song about Waffle House or a song about a very specific feeling, a song about this one time in high school, you know. And I'll kind of take those taglines, almost like TV pitches, and I'll decide if they get a pilot. So if I decide that I want to make this one particular tagline a song, then I will sit down for about an hour and a half, and I'll write it out. And if I finish the song in one sitting, it becomes a Hard Fabric song. If I don't finish the song in one sitting, I will never come back to it, and usually it's scrapped. Just because I feel like when I kind of get on that that thought process. Like, I'll be able to stay there for the duration of writing the song, but if I try and come back a different time, I'll be in a different mindset. So it's a really kind of strange process, and a lot of the songs that I've wanted to write because of that have just not gotten written. But then there's songs that I'll have the idea for like 2 minutes before that become like the ones that everyone is into. Like Sociology, the hook for that song was literally just something that popped into my head, and I probably wrote Sociology in all of 2 hours. So
gotcha. I go about it a little bit different, because I will sit there and I'll have an idea for a long time.
Yeah.
Like, I've had a riff bumping around in my head now for a long time that was actually me trying to learn an Ozzy Osbourne song, and I kept messing it up, but it sounded good. And I was like, okay, we're going to keep that because it's kind of catchy. We can use that hook for something else later. Or I'll write a lyric that inspires me or my fellow musicians in the band to write something for the song that we're doing together. And it just depends on who's got what. Like, there are times when I come in, I don't normally play guitar in the groups I'm in, but I'll come up and be like, hey, we're going to play this. Mm-hmm. Or I'll come up with lyrics and ask them to write something for it. So it's very collaborative in nature. It just depends on the song when you go back through and listen to them. Yeah, so why don't you tell us about the song that you wanted to play for us today?
Okay, so this one is one of my personal favorites. It's a song about Waffle House. It doesn't really have a name yet. It's sometimes Waffle Home, sometimes Waho, sometimes that song about Waffle House. But essentially, growing up in Georgia and growing up in Augusta, Georgia, where there's a Waffle House literally like every road in Augusta, I feel like, has at least three Waffle Houses on it. And sometimes they're like two buildings down. So it's...
But it's important to remember, each Waffle House has its own character.
Oh, yeah. And
don't let anybody tell you different.
And that's the thing. The song Waffle House that I'm about to perform is about one particular Waffle House in front of the Evans 14 movie theater in Augusta, Georgia. And it's basically just about the different stories that I've had there throughout high school. So me and my buddies, what we would do is after work, we'd get off. We'd go to the city park and we'd jam. We'd, kind of throw ideas back and forth on music. That was like when I was first getting into music. And we would always end our nights at Waffle House. And
as most good nights end.
Yeah, exactly. So, you know, you're coming into Waffle House at like 3 a.m. You're tired as hell and you don't know why you're drinking coffee, because you know right after Waffle House you'll probably crawl into bed. But you're drinking coffee after coffee after coffee, talking about philosophy and shit. You're like... we knew this one guy in the Waffle House who actually ended up in the song named Paul. And Paul was literally just always at Waffle House. I went into the same Waffle House during the day once and Paul was there. So, like, he didn't work there, but he was always up to something. So, for instance, we had gone in to that Waffle House after watching the midnight premiere of The Force Awakens. And Paul was out with, like, two other Waffle House employees shooting bottle rockets from an ashtray in the Waffle House parking lot. And it was so bizarre, but it's something that would only happen at a Waffle House. It's something that would have been kind of confusing anywhere else, but at a Waffle House, it just makes sense. So, I don't know, some people have specific like dive bars that they like to go to and they know everybody there and they become regulars and they talk about their life with the people who work there. For me, I think that's Waffle House. You go into a Waffle House and it feels like a home, and it feels like, you know, everyone there is family in a way. You know, they're there to make you a nice hot meal, smoke a cigarette with you, and talk about life. So it's really cool.
Yeah. All right. Well, let's get to that song and we'll be back in just a second with it.
Whoop. Okay. Hey everyone. This is Hard Fabric and this is Waho.
And gas stations and living rooms. The expeditions never stop. 11 yellow figures in the sky lit up the night. Me and countless lost companions packed ourselves in super tightly. Little little plastic booths adorned with tables barely big enough to hold the 18,000 plates of greasy breakfast sustenance. Came back every couple nights, and it always tasted best when you were easing out of consciousness with Jim Beam on your breath. That guy Paul was always there for us, not sure if he was homeless, shooting bottle rockets from the ashtray sitting by the entrance. The only place where you could smoke a pack out with your cook, by the dumpsters, just discussing all those chances that you took. And coffee never tasted quite the same way that it did those nights we stood up till the sunrise down in caffeinated bliss. Where are my friends, my car, and freedom were the only things that mattered before I paid my bills and life got smothered, chunked, and scattered. Everyone's got somewhere that they'll always feel accepted. My happy place just happens to take credit, cash, or debit. It's a little bit unorthodox and a little bit unclean, but Waffle House just feels like home to me. For $7.99, the profits turn water to wine. But who needs wine when you've got Texas patty melts and pecan pie? When I die, dress my gravestone with a similar marquee, so that the drunks and truckers on the freeway say a prayer for me. Make their eggs to order, give them coffee into gold cups, and surround them with the ones that make them happy till they've sobered up. Oh,